So good afternoon. I'm Christian Bertin from ST Microelectronics. This presentation has been set up by Serge De Paoli, who is working in my team on trace and debugging. So he has some problem to join us at the Connect. So I take the responsibility of presenting his work. So don't be too demanding with me. On me, if you have question, very technical question, we will be able to organize some discussion with Serge on demand. Okay. So the presentation is about multi-target trace, MTT, and the objective of this presentation are partially covered by other open source tools and other commercial tools. That's the reason why we think there are some interest in maybe reusing part of this work in the current open source offer. So the objectives are to provide system trace for memory constraints devices, embedded devices, where you have a small memory and you cannot afford a big expansion of the kernel if you use the instrumentation method, to support both Linux and non-Linux core, to take benefit from hardware, of course, as a ARM core size when it's available, and also to ease the usage of tracing for non-kernel experts. Typically, you would like to avoid having to recompile several times the kernel for using trace. Yes? No? Okay. So this project started more than 10 years ago. That's the reason why we have our own solution for tracing, which is called KP Trace. You will see that from time to time in the presentation. But the goal is not today to present you KP Trace, because from a functional standpoint, KP Trace is almost the same as F Trace. So we have not the intention to replace F Trace by KP Trace. This is not the point here. The point here is to benefit from some aspect of the ST system trace that we put in place for multiplexing trace when you have several cores on your SOC, different cores on your SOC. So it's a unified and complete solution to generate, capture, decode, display system trace for embedded SOCs. So you have two parts, one part on the target system, which provides support to trace the kernel activity, API to generate trace from user space and kernel space. It's also MTT, a data protocol for encoding traces. And it allows to the user to select a backend driver. It could be the core side backend driver or the relay FS to generate trace through kernel user buffer. And of course, it allows the user to stop, start, and filter traces. On the remote workstation, you have tools to connect to the target and to configure the type of trace that you want to capture, the point of trace that you want to get. And then to decode and display traces. So this is the overall overview. You have here the target system, user space, kernel space, an API to generate trace between user space and the tracing system. The same API can be used with companion cores, which are not running Linux, which could be running R2Cs or bare metal application. And on the workstation, you have, of course, command line tools to decode the trace, to filter it and display it. And these command line tools could be, controlled through by a more general GUI tool, an Eclipse-based tool. And you have a trace transport layer that carries a trace from the target to the host, generally for an Ethernet connection or a USB connection. This is the overall architecture of the MTT framework. So on this square represents the target, And outside of the square, you have the, let's say the remote, the capture box, and the remote workstation. So KPTrace, in fact, is based on the Linux kprobe. The method for capturing the trace is based on breakpointing using more or less ptrace. This is the method to use. It means that when you want to trace something, in fact, you replace the instruction in the kernel or in the user application by a breakpoint, and the control is passed to the kprobe hook that will be tracing the what you want to trace, and then you are back to the instruction to execute it. So it's less, it's a bit intrusive. It has some it can have some a bit of overhead. It could lead to some overhead in the kernel, but it's not a static instrumentation like you can do with ftrace or with LTTNG, where if you activate all the trace points of the kernel, for instance, you will double or triple the size of your kernel, which is not acceptable on a very small memory configuration. So this is the overall framework. You have the possibility to connect to the MTT backend two possible, methods to get the trace out of the target, either the CoreSite driver or the relay FS of the kernel. And you can, the remote workstation can get can dialogue with the MTT daemon, which is started when you launch a tracing session. So I will come back on that. So MTT is a light mechanism to generate and capture traces from several producers. So this is the interesting aspect that we would like open source solution to benefit from, because it captures these traces in a single flow, which will have a single a unique time stamping reference, I would say. So kernel activity could be traced thanks to kprobe, user application thanks to an API allowing user traces, and companion processors. So this is where we have something very interesting for a developer who has to debug an application using Linux on one side and several companion cores on the other side, and falling on difficult issue like synchronization problem, one core who is starving because of wrong scheduling. So thanks to this unique trace flow, you will be able to correlate the events on the different cores and find out what is your problem. So it's composed of two principal layers: the MTT framework, which I briefly described a few minutes ago, and some utility for controlling the trace. So a collection of kprobe and command line tools like MTT control. Okay, if you have questions, don't hesitate to ask me. So how does it run? The MTT framework is in the idle state when we start, and it is waiting for a driver to be registered. It could be the CoreSite driver or the relay FS driver. And as soon as it is done, the system is ready to run. So it's a kind of state machine, and the end user can start and stop traces or send filter command. So this is how it works. I think we have seen that already. With regard to the MTT API, so it is quite simple. We are giving here some function call examples. You have open, close, trace, and print. It's most of it. Okay. Another aspect of MTT is that the trace is encoded in binary format, which means that the trace elements, the trace components sent to the tracing channels are quite short because they are encoded. And then we have on the remote workstation, we have a command line tool to decode the trace. So this the format used is, of course, the MTT format invented by us, by ST, but it could be a different one. It could be, for instance, the MIPI-CST format, which is under definition. If one day we have to align on this standard, it's quite possible. The kind of trace port that we are using to capture the trace routed through the Corsair TPIU. We have in ST we have a box with a 4-bit trace data width and a MIPI 34 connector. And these boxes are used, and we use also we can use also this system on the combi probe from Lauterbach, which is a commercial probe box used for capturing trace on your socks. But over we tried over capture box like ARM DS5 or EAR iJet trace. So just to tell you that this MTT framework could be used on any kind of a capture box. From the remote workstation, the workstation can send command to the trace diamond through a socket. Command line tools allow to launch session and decode them. And we can encapsulate all these command lines inside an Eclipse GUI. When we are using the combi probe, the command line tools retrieve raw data from a pipe. When STM probe is used, the command line tools retrieve data from USB connection. The remote workstation is connected to the capture bolt through USB. And when there is no capture box in file mode, in this case, trace files are retrieved from the board using an SCP command from a socket port. So this is an example of the trace decoding. So this is part of what we call the trace post-processing. As I said, the trace are recorded in binary format when they are captured by the MTT framework. And MTT provides a set of command line tools to extract these traces. So in this example, it's I think this is a trace of a trace point corresponding to context switch under Linux, with also a system trap entry and exit from system calls from user to kernel, and IX is the interrupt exist. So you can follow this event and understand what is being scheduled on your machine and which arguments are passed at each system call. So it could be useful to.
What does PID 0 mean?
PID is the.
I know the 960 probably the PID of the process, but what does the 0 mean?
If the context switch is happening, it's the kernel swapper, and the kernel swapper will typically have a PID of 0.
Yeah, I think we are under the kernel.
Well, obviously you are under the kernel at that point, but if we are doing a system call or a context switch, this is the swapper thread, and the swapper thread for each CPU
is zero.
A PID of 0.
Yeah, like process 0. Okay. For instance, here on this is a kind of a diagram that we can rebuild from a tracing session where you you can see various processes being activated and being scheduled on the machine. This is the idle task on the bottom. So you can figure out what is happening on your machine. You can for instance discover that a task is being is starving or is being scheduled too late or things like that. The idea of this MTT framework is that it can be used with other OSIs, and this is what we did in ST. We tried it with FreeRTOS. FreeRTOS has callback that can be invoked when the kernel is performing a given action, and thanks to this callback, we can also trace things. We tried it also with OS21, an ST proprietary kernel that still in production in ST. So the point is that it could be also used with a potential solution for Zephyr or embed in the IoT, if you want to understand what is happening on your IoT system. So to summarize, the benefits of MTT are the following: multiplexing. All traces from software components are interleaved into the same trace flow with a unique time stamping. MTT is well suited for memory constraints devices. It's using kprobe, so there is no static instrumentation, no code bloat. The ring buffer is based on relay FS kernel API, so there is no need for an internal ring buffer to capture trace. When the core site is used as output, there is no ring buffer instantiated either. The third benefit is that MTT is well suited for boards which are not equipped with Ethernet. MTT does not require the user to be a kernel guru or hacker. This is true because the KPTrace tools is providing some predefined trace point or based on kprobe, but still the end user has to understand what he's doing and what he's trying to observe on the system. He needs to have some kernel knowledge. What is interesting in terms of software engineering, I know here in Linaro you are used to, in members team, you are used to recompile the kernel at will, but when you have customers using kernel in production, we prefer that the end user recompile the kernel as less as possible, because it's always a problem to recompile the kernel. So if you have a tracing method that doesn't require to continuously recompile the customer kernel, it's a better situation. But this being said, we have tried to measure the overhead of kprobe usage, and because this has to be trade-off versus the code augmentation if you use the static instrumentation. And this is ongoing. I have we have some comparison with CycleSoap, but we should also compare MTT based on kprobe with ftrace, for instance, or with LTTNG.
Just want to go back here on what you said earlier on this slide, saying that you want to reuse the same kernel without having to recompile it?
To avoid.
Right. So, but it's important to understand here that you still need to have a sufficient amount of traces already included in the kernel in order to do the traces. Because the MTT trace points are not there by default. You have enabled them in your kernel config when you have recompiled the kernel.
On kprobe, this is a dynamic method.
Right,
you don't have to recompile the kernel. as long as the trace point that you wanted to have are compiled there in the first place.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So you cannot, if you want to introduce more trace points, you need to recompile the kernel.
No needed. Actually, no, no needed.
Have you used it?
Yeah. You are comparing with LTTNG, but how about ftrace? ftrace already support that dynamic probe, which is also adding that dynamic correct. Trace point.
Correct.
Yeah.
The only difference here is that the trace tool that we have developed in ST mm-hmm. is providing a catalog of additional trace point compared to ftrace. And I think this could be integrated into ftrace. We could be something that could be done to have more possibility, predefined possibility for the end user than today in ftrace. Today in ftrace, you have a single way of a single method for define using kprobe trace point.
What kind of the catalog are you? Mean, would you
for
mean?
Instance, if you want to follow context switches, the KP trace catalog is has already predefined a trace point for kprobe for this type of event.
But if you can predefine the trace point, it should be done in by your static trace point like statically, like in our source code, because that's a dynamic trace point. Takes some kind of overhead to trace. So if you can predefine that, it is better.
No, you
to
have
like
overhead only if you activate the trace point.
Yeah.
When you dialogue with your framework, you will when the MTT daemon is running. You will activate trace point until the trace point is not as long as the trace point is not activated, there is no overhead because the kprobe is not active. The instruction is still the instruction kernel that you execute. You don't divert the execution of the
I see. But when you enable the
as soon
activated.
As it is enabled, yes, you have a
yeah, and also our current static trace point using that, the dynamic jump self-modifying code, so that usually it takes very, very small performance impact for that.
Yeah, the overhead should not be that high, I think. We have some measure. You know cycle clock? Yeah.
Usually it's just a jump. It's usually just a knob. And it's like a compiler magic we are using that to implement the trace point. The tracing block is actually compiled as a unlikely block, which is placed on the tail of function, and the jump code is actually replaced by NOP. And if we enable the trace point, the NOP is replaced by jump.
That is a static trace point.
Yeah, static trace point.
My question is
No, I mean that the static trace point is, also, yes.
Ah, okay. Okay, okay. So, MTT framework is currently used in ST products on Cortex-A9 SMP with the Linux 3.10 kernel. Also on A53 SMP with LSK 4.4, 64-bit architecture, using LSK 4.4. It's in use, in production.
and I am at the end of the presentation, we would like to make this work available to whoever would like to test it and use it. So we propose to make it open source, to make open source the MTT code patch set, the patch sets that are required that you have to apply to the kernel for activating the MTT framework. Then, if there is some interest, if the community is motivated by this approach, we could go further by submitting these patches, try to upstream these patches, but we are not there yet. We were first to make it open source for people to make experiments with that. Then, in the second step, we could make open source as well the command line tools, like MTT, the Daemon, MTTMD, MTT control, and also kptrace for cherry picking function here and there from kptrace. For instance, we could consider extending ftrace with additional trace point based on kptrace, because ftrace is now an established tool in the community, and we have we don't want to replace ftrace. This is not our goal. Our goal is to see if there are some improvements in ftrace that could benefit from what we have done in kptrace, but this requires some experiment. And then we can go further with remote tools, make the remote tools open source. We plan to start this on GitHub, for instance. So that's it. So if you have more questions and if you are interested in this work, you don't hesitate to start contact with Serge De Paoli.
I ask now.
Yes.
So how is the user space trace? I think you present a lot on the kernel space trace. So what do I need to modify the source code to call the API so that I can do the user space level trace? Or don't?
Yes. Yes.
I have to modify the source code. Like the MTT open and MTT print stuff in my code.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So the trace hardware you talked about, the trace hardware you talked about, is it some JTAG probe that also does the JTAG debugging in conjunction with the tracing capability, or it's just the tracing agent?
It's a TPIU port.
Okay.
It's a full port site.
Okay. So it's not a JTAG probe.
No,
that
pure port site.
And can we do JTAG debugging in conjunction with this?
I would say so, yes.
Okay.
There is no objection to that. I mean, no contradiction to that.
Yeah, because ST is also offered the JTAG probe as well.
Yes.
So was there a use case that sort of utilized both these hardwares in parallel?
I think so, yes.
Okay.
So that's hardware dependent. If your core site is on the same clock as your JTAG, it's not going to work.
Okay.
So it would have to be independent. But if you have two independent ways of driving
any interest in this? No? Okay. So thank you very much.